Well, as we've thought about over the last couple of Sunday evenings, as we've gone through chapters 7 and 8, we've found, I trust, that there is in Esther a growing picture of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. It begins with Esther in chapter 6 being prepared to lay down her own life. She says, "If I die, I die." Before then, she goes to approach King Xerxes and is prepared to risk all for her people to be rescued. The king's anger is then burned against Haman when Haman's evil is exposed. And again, that's a picture, isn't it, of God's anger that burns against those when our sin, our evil is exposed. The difference being that the king's anger was brought to, was dealt with, peace was felt when Haman was put to death, and wonderfully, you know, miraculously, in God's justice, God's anger against our sin is satisfied not by our death, but by the death of Jesus. And then we find in chapter 8, as we were thinking about last time, there Esther comes and she, with Mordecai, creates a new law, a law to counteract the actions of the first law. And it's another picture of the Lord Jesus Christ creating that new covenant, a covenant of grace that we find spoken about in the New Testament. You know, because Jesus didn't come to remove the law, he completed the law. He perfected the law in every possible way. And then creates another law, another way in which for us to find and know and enjoy peace. And we found at the end of the chapter, at the end of chapter 8 there, in verse 15 and 16, that there in Susa there is joyous celebration for the Jews at a time of happiness and joy, gladness and honour. And they're feasting and celebrating, not because they've been fully released or freedom had been finally given to them fully, but they were celebrating in anticipation of what they were going to receive. That they knew that the day that had been appointed for them to die wasn't going to be a day of death, but instead was going to be a day of life. A day when life for them would become ongoing. And we thought about how, as believers, we can have an anticipation of ongoing, eternal life. And the day that we physically depart this world is not the day that everything ends. The day that life continues on with the favour and the blessing of our God in eternity with him. And as we read through then the book of Esther and Mordecai, I hope what we've had is a sense of how both at times Esther and Mordecai picture to us not only the work and the function of the Lord Jesus, but also at times the way that we as Christians act and respond out of the relationship that we have with our God, with our King, and the freedom that he brings to us. And in some ways, it's not surprising that both the lives of Mordecai and Esther interchangeably talk about and display different elements of Jesus and Christians to us. Why? Well, as Christians, we are going to model something of the life of Jesus. You know, we see, and we're supposed to see, Jesus in the lives of his people, in the lives of one another. And so they're going to be echoes of Jesus' character and Jesus' dealings with people in our own lives, and especially here in the Old Testament. It's one of the reasons why the book of Esther is kept in the scriptures, though there's been debate over many years. And as we've said at the start, God is not mentioned in this book at all. And the reason why, therefore, it remains here is because this is a picture that powerfully points to what God was going to do. God is unseen in many senses, and yet we can't help but see God, can we, on every page as we read through it and see God working in the background, orchestrating everything. So this is a book that shows us about God's providence, the unseen working of God in the lives of his people. And in that sense, actually, it's a helpful reminder for us, isn't it, that God is unseen often in our lives, but he is working nonetheless. We can trust him to watch over us, to guard us, And we can have a confidence that he is working. We don't get big sort of neon signs or angels appearing to us and saying, this is what God's going to do any longer. But we do have God continuing to work and deal with us out of his goodness. So there's three things for us to think about as we consider these last couple of chapters this evening. I have to say, as I pointed out, there are some squeamish things to this chapter, aren't there? We have gentle Esther suddenly becoming really bloodthirsty, and there's some really awkward elements as she comes and petitions the king and says, the Jews have killed a load of people, I want them to be able to do it again today. And we need to be careful about the way we understand that and the language that we use on it, but actually the focus is not so much on what they do in those couple of their actions in terms of killing, but rather there are some pictures of what it symbolizes instead. Now, there's on that side. So the first thing we need to think about this evening is precious, things that are precious. It does look, doesn't it, there in verses 5, verse 13, verse 15 of chapter 9, that everything takes a very dark twist. It's repeated several times there from verse 5. The Jews struck down all their enemies, verse 13. They're to have permission to carry out the day's edict tomorrow as well, verse 15. They came together on the 14th day of the month of Adar, and they put to death in Susa 300 men. This isn't something to take lightly, is it? Esther, it seems, not only is asking for this, but she pushes it even further. We're told that Haman's 10 sons had already been put to death, but we're told there in verse 13 that Esther says, actually, I also want Haman's sons to be impaled or hung on the gallows that he created. And you go, oh, Esther, really? You're supposed to be the gentle one in the story. You're the one that's sort of held back, and you're the one who's interceding for mercy and grace. But the point we find, I think, particularly through this chapter, is that they are only acting out of self-defense, aren't they? If you look back into chapter 8, verse 11, we're told there, chapter 8, verse 11, the king's edict granted the Jews in every city the right to assemble to protect themselves, to destroy, kill, and annihilate the armed men of any nationality or province who might attack them and their women and children. They are only acting in defense. That they're not going out in these little armed gangs seeking people who've forgotten to return their garden shears or the lawnmower, or they've borrowed a book and it's never been brought back to them, and they're going, I'm going to get those who've just driven us nuts. Now I'm fed up of being patient for them. They are only to defend themselves against those who are outright seeking to go against them, seeking to defend themselves against their own enemies. They had every legal ability to do so. They're seeking to gain their own protection. But we're told something really clearly. It's repeated three times as well through this passage. After every mention of death and destruction, there in verse 10, verse 15, verse 16, we're told three times, but they did not lay their hands on the plunder. They actually had every right to go and take the plunder, the property. In fact, we're told that if you look back again in chapter 8, verse 11, we're told that when they defend themselves, they are to plunder the property of their enemies. They had every license under law to not only wipe out their enemies, but to claim all of their possessions as theirs. And yet, it's very pointedly given to us that they didn't on any occasion. See, that would have been perfectly legal for them. They weren't going to be taking their hand in it. Well, what does that demonstrate? Well, in some ways it demonstrates for us that they're not greedy. No, they were simply only looking for their own protection. But actually, it's even stronger than that. What were they doing as they rejected the plunder? But rejecting taking any of the benefits of sin, or rejecting taking anything that had been tainted by association to evil and bringing it into their own homes. you know, the stuff that belonged to these enemies. No, it was the stuff that belonged to, there was a picture of sin. Remember, Haman's plan, now Haman's evil was echoed by these individuals. Now Haman is the pick, and his plot and his intention to kill the Jews is a picture of the sinfulness and the breaking of law. And there's these other men and individuals in the country align themselves with Haman. You know, these individuals and their possessions, everything that they have is tainted by that evil sinfulness. And the Jews said, we're not going to take any part of the ill-gotten gains. You know, there are things that we cannot be associated with, and anything that is a picture of the evilness and the brokenness that was amongst us, anything that was, you know, part of the curse that was put against us, we're not going to take part in it. Why? Because they'd gained life. They'd gained freedom from the law. They'd gained freedom from all the consequences of the law that had been put in place. And they didn't want to have anything that would taint it and make them look like they're only acting to further their own sort of purposes, to add to their material wealth. They were satisfied enough in having life. They didn't then need to feel that they had additional material riches as well. They weren't interested in the riches. They were interested instead with the life. And what were they doing? Why was it that they were acting in defence? Why were they able to put to death those who were their enemies? Actually, it's a picture, isn't it, of them removing the presence of sin amongst them. And isn't that actually what we're all called to do as believers? For there not to be any remaining sin, or for us to look to enjoy any of the benefits or the so-called, you know, riches that sin might offer or hold out to us. When you look into the New Testament, we find, don't we, in Romans chapter 6 and throughout the whole letter of 1 John, we're called to be separate from sin. We're called not to be entangled with anything that has taint on it. In fact, just turn with me briefly to Ephesians chapter 5. Paul really sort of clearly spells this out here in Ephesians chapter 5. Ephesians chapter 5, have a look there at verse 3. Paul writing to the church here, he's getting towards the end of his letter, so it's more practical in what he's writing. He says, Ephesians 5, verse 3, but among you there must not be even a hint of sexual immorality, or any kind of impurity, or of greed, because these are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving. Paul says there's to be no hint of sin amongst us. There's going to be no taint. There's got to be, you know, no even sort of savour of it or even association with it with us as believers. The Jews in Susa and throughout the empire, they didn't want to have any association with the things that had been wrapped up with that evil plot and plan, the sin that had been sort of manifest towards them. There are things, aren't there, in our day and age that have been spoiled, tainted by sin, maybe by our own, but certainly by the sin of the world round about us, things that we don't want to be associated with, things that we cannot take into our own homes and say, yeah, I'm going to enjoy something from this. There are things, aren't there, that we don't even want to touch or be seen to be engaging with in any possible way. For example, how do you invest your finances? Are we careful about the type of companies that we put our finances into, the shares that we hold? Are we benefiting from sinful things? We wouldn't want to be investing in gambling companies or companies that necessarily produce certain things that might be misused or abused in other places. We don't want to be gaining from something that is tainted by the evil actions of others. We need to be, want to make sure that we're separated from that. Why? Because we don't enjoy anything sinful of ourselves. Why would we engage in it in some way with others? What about our media consumption? There are films, aren't there? TV programs. It's probably quite hard to avoid in some senses, but you know, where there's intimate scenes. If someone is acting those out, they might be married to someone else, but they're doing something that is unbiblical. It's for maybe for entertainment. It's something that should only happen between a married couple. How can we watch something like that? There's a taint by being associated or seen with enjoying that. We don't want there to be any hint of taint amongst us, do we, as God's people? Why? Because we want to enjoy, we don't want anything to hinder the enjoyment of the life that we now have with God, the freedom, the justice of God, the righteousness of God that we've come to know. When we engage with things like that, what does it do? But it just opens the door and says, I'm going to enjoy something that really God has said is not right and a degree of evil. He's a Puritan writer, really, but John Owen said this, be killing sin or it will be killing you. Be serious about rooting it out and sharing no part or having any hand in the things that take place that are evil round about us. Why? Because our life with God is precious, isn't it? When we look at what Jesus did to save us, when we look at the relationship that we enjoy with God now, we count it as precious. And when there's something precious, what do? You look to preserve it so that there might be nothing that'll sort of lessen it or put it sort of in a put it at a degree of unease. We protect it. Paul says, let there be no hint. The Jews here are going to make sure that there is no hint of evil, no being faced by them, that there's no hint of that evil even being taken into their own home, benefiting from it in some possible way. So they demonstrate that it's the salvation, the life they've come to know is precious. And they're going to guard it, and that's the way we're supposed to act too, isn't it? To guard, to make sure that nothing comes into our homes, into our hearts, that just takes away from the joy of the relationship that we can have with God. And then secondly, we have a party. We're told from verse 16 onwards that right the way through to the end of chapter 9, the Jews have a day of celebration. We're told that the rural Jews celebrated it on the 14th of the month, but those in the city had it on the 15th day of the month. And this ends up becoming the celebration known as the Feast of Purim. And that's something that we find being particularly established there through the rest of the chapter. Verse 26, we're told that therefore these days were called Purim, for the word Pur, because of everything written in this letter and because of what they had seen and what had happened to them. The Jews took it on themselves to establish the custom that they and their descendants and all who would join with them without fail observe these 2 days every year in the way prescribed and at the time appointed. Well, we all know what it's like to have significant and special events. We have those, don't we, littered throughout the year. And actually, we enjoy moments of celebration. You know, birthdays, wedding anniversaries, Easter, Christmas. We have services of remembrance, don't we? We remember perhaps you have in your company. I don't know whether the company still do it, but you might get a special know, presentation after you've been with the company 25 years or 30 years or something like that. Just a recognition of service and the good things that you've done over the length of time. And that's in some ways what's happening as this Feast of Purim is set up. This Feast of Purim to remember the deliverance that the Jews had felt, the freedom, the life that was granted to them. It's a good thing. Paul says actually in Romans chapter 14, he talks about those who celebrate special days. If you want to celebrate a special day, if you want to create new festivals, there's nothing wrong with that, Paul says. That's okay. Why? Because actually it's good, isn't it, to remember the good things that God has done, or the blessings that we've come to know or enjoy. Now, Esther and Mordecai, we're not told that they're explicit, that God said to them, by the way, this is going to be a new feast that you're going to celebrate. And yet this is something that they wanted to do, but obviously the rest of the Jews wanted it as well, because they took it on, and we, as we read there in verse 26 and 27, they bind themselves to carrying it on. Not just they binding themselves, but they bind the future generations and everyone who joins with them. Everybody who becomes a Jew by choice, and who becomes part of the people of Israel. And there were several at this time who were doing that. And we want to recognize the good thing that's happened here, the deliverance, the life that we've now come to enjoy, the freedom. Apparently Purim this year comes on the 23rd and 24th of March. So if you know any Jews, good to be aware of it. You might be able to make use of that in some sense of your witness to them. But what are they doing over these 2 days as they celebrate the Feast of Purim? They're celebrating the freedom and the life that had been granted to them. It's similar, isn't it, to Passover. When the Jews were brought out of Egypt by the Passover lamb being sacrificed and the blood being put on the doorpost as they were brought out of Egypt. Now again, it's another feast celebrating the life and the freedom that God brought. Do you have, by the way, any personal moments or ways in which you mark moments of God's mercy to you? It's not wrong for us to see how God has provided for us. Okay, it might not be that you take some of your personal moments and turn them into a celebration for the entire church. That's probably not going to be the case, is it? But it is right for us to go, well, actually, are there things that I can see that God has done for me? Moments of his mercy and grace in my life. But I'm just going to make a moment to take note of. It doesn't necessarily need to be anything significant, does it? But just simply in my heart, make a note to remember. And this is what the Lord has done for me at this point and at this point in our lives. And I'm sure we all have different ones of that personally. But the picture here is that this is a celebration that all the Jews celebrate. One that all the people recognised. They recognised, all of them together, the goodness of God. Well, we don't have any real sort of feasts or celebrations as a church today, do we? I mean, Harvest is a bit of a feast for us here at Tollgate, and we do things at other times as well, maybe church anniversary. But really, what's this a picture I'm pointing towards? This is a picture of the Lord's people celebrating, remembering what God did to bring life. What's that? It's the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. It's a picture of the time when we come together around the Lord's table to celebrate communion, to share the Lord's Supper, reminding ourselves together, because though it's just a small bit of bread and a small cup of non-alcoholic wine, it's a feast. It's a feast to remember the good thing of God to us, the blessings that he's poured out on us. It's a feast to remember when God did everything possible to move us out of under the condemnation of the law into his grace, from death to life. That's what we do at Easter, isn't it? We do that more obviously, perhaps. What we do when we have a baptism, it's a display of know, the confession of faith of someone, but baptism itself, we know, is a picture of, you know, death and resurrection. Now, baptism is a time of rejoicing, isn't it? It's a fellowship. Of seeing what God has done in someone else, in one person's heart and life, remembering it ourselves. Sundays. You know, what are our times together on Sundays? But, you know, at the start of a new week, just as the Lord Jesus was raised to dead on the first day of a week, we are together again at the start of every single week, coming together and in some senses celebrating that we have a risen Saviour as we come to him in worship. As we gather together and we sing to him and we sing of his greatness and we sing of his love and we sing of the experience that we have as individuals and as a fellowship together of his forgiveness and pardon and life. And then nobody would say that any of those things are parties, are they? We don't have, you know, balloons up around the place. I mean, there are going to be some churches that do that at some point, aren't there? But it's a feast. You know, of remembering everything that God has done. It's what we want, isn't it? Because you know, the Jews here in this passage, they're celebrating and they're rejoicing and they're going to keep as a continual feast a day on which, you know, one day when they were physically made safe. And actually, don't we want to remember on every day, certain days more than others, that we've been made safe, not just physically, but we've been made safe for all of eternity. That there is no condemnation for us to face, that Christ has once and for all offered the sacrifice that will bring us to God. He has dealt with everything. The middle wall has been broken down. The way to God is opened up. That there is life and the Spirit now within us. There's a hope of heaven. Don't we want to keep remembering that? And when we come around the Lord's table together, when we spend time on Sundays together, you know, do we have in our hearts and our minds that we're doing this to deliberately remember all that our Saviour's done? One of the things we find that perhaps different churches might do different things or different styles, but no, there's often a lot of silence, isn't there, around the time of communion. We had that this morning. Or is it that we're all just sat there in silence, just waiting for, you know, the next element of the feast to be passed round to us? No, it's a moment when we can, in our own hearts, give thanks to God. We're doing it and sharing it together, but it's also a personal thing as we celebrate afresh what the symbols before us represent in the death and the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. But it's not just those times together as a fellowship, is it? Actually, we can celebrate in some senses the life that Jesus has brought to us every day. How do we do that? Actually, the best way to enjoy the life that God has given to us is to live it. It is to live in lives that display the relationship that we have with God, lives that show that we are not cut off from him, lives that feel and enjoy the boldness of approaching our Father in heaven and engage in meaningfully living for him day after day after day. The Jews make it say, we're going to remember the good things of God to us. How often do you make a pattern of just consciously quietening your heart and remembering all the good things of God? Beginning with salvation and then everything since then as well. It's one of the things that at times, I think that when you look back through the history of Israel, they did this well, didn't they? And the Lord gave them so many different opportunities and times to say, look at all that I've done for you. And here's another one that they created. It's right that we take time at points to very deliberately, pointedly rejoice over, celebrate the good things that God has done for us. And then thirdly, we have position. At the end of the Disney film Finding Nemo, they achieve their goal, and then one of the characters says, "Now what?" And in some ways, you get to the end of this book and you go, "Well, yeah, now what?" Right? You know, they've achieved everything that this book sets out to put before us. We now understand why the Feast of Purim was initiated for the Jews. But now what? Now there's everything that they've hoped for. How are they then going to carry on? We get to the end of the book and we find that Esther is queen, Mordecai is the prime minister. The Jews now know peace and blessing in their land. They know a growing success and favour, and even they find there are many others who are joining with them. There seems to be this growing people of God. Well, actually, we find some pictures again with the life of Mordecai there in those last few verses of chapter 10. And we're told that Mordecai becomes great. He is put in a high position. At the start of chapter 9, we're told there in verses 3 and 4 that fear of Mordecai had seized the officials. Verse 4, Mordecai was prominent in the palace. His reputation spread throughout the provinces and he became more and more powerful. And then in chapter 10, verse 2, we're told that the actions of Xerxes are recorded, but also the greatness of Mordecai. And Mordecai continues to be elevated in everybody's sight and gain favour, it appears, with everybody. And in some ways, the way that Mordecai acts ends up reflecting on the people, and they all come to know a greater blessing because of Mordecai's position. Actually, there's a sense in which when you read those comments there about Mordecai, you just go, this sounds a little bit like Daniel, doesn't it? Here's a man of God in a prominent position who knows the favour of others, or at least becomes feared. There's a reverence of him and a respect of him because of how well he does in all things. Well, Mordecai, what kind of a leader is he going to be? Now, here's a man who was under threat of his own life. He's now got all power and authority. He could, if he really wanted to, cause all kinds of problems among the land, couldn't he? Oh, well, you know, we had someone that tried to get rid of the Jews. I'm going to, you know, turn this back and try and deal with some other people who just wound me up in the same way that Haman found Mordecai had been wound him up. And yet he doesn't, does he? How does he act? Well, he acts caring obviously for his people, but he obviously acts in a good way. He embodies 1 Peter chapter 3 verse 9, which says, "Do not repay evil for evil." Now he's got this immense power, and now he doesn't bear it against anyone. Instead, he uses it and demonstrates 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 12, which says, "Let your conduct among the Gentiles be honourable." The way that believers are supposed to act, what is it? It's supposed to be honourable. The way that we engage with those round about us, the way that we consider each other, there is supposed to be a degree of honour. In fact, just to turn to 1 Peter chapter 2, because Peter says something else there in chapter 2. That's helpful for us, and I think pictures Mordecai so wonderfully. Peter chapter 2 verse 12, what do we see here? Peter says, "Live such good lives among the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us." Now, there's an inevitability that Mordecai, in a position of authority, is not going to be favoured by everybody. There will be some that no doubt will resent the fact that this Jew now has immense sway through the land. And yet the way he conducts himself means that his good deeds were seen. God was glorified by the way that he acted and the governing that he brought to the people. He ends up having a good reputation. Now here is a man who knows grace, who leads in the country with a measure of grace. Having obtained mercy, he then deals with mercy. There's no other way, is there, to explain otherwise why he is so liked, even by those who are native to the land. In some ways, doesn't that describe how we as Christians, when we've come to know our salvation, when we've come to know and enjoy the favour of God, how we are to go on living in our land? When you look at the relationships or think about the reputation that you have with your colleagues or your family, do you have a good reputation because you're a Christian? Do you have a good Christian reputation as opposed to a good reputation but they say, there's a footnote, he's a Christian? The way you conduct yourself, does it even look good to those round about us? We are supposed to consider the position that we have. Why? Because as Mordecai has looked at, what does it do? It builds the favour with the people for the rest of the Jews as well. And Mordecai's conduct, as you read in chapter 9, verse 3 and 4, that had an impact on how all of his people were considered. And the way that we act amongst those in our offices, those we brush shoulders against daily, the way that we act is going to have an impact on how they think about other Christians as well. Is our conduct in such a way that builds them up? But then there's something else that we're told particularly about Mordecai, is that we're told there right at the end of chapter verse 3 that he worked for the good of his people and spoke up for the welfare of all the Jews. The NIV, I think, translate this almost unhelpfully, because actually that word welfare there is peace. Shalom. Peace. Mordecai speaks peace to the Jews. That's the more literal translation. He speaks peace to the Jews. And in that sense, doesn't Mordecai so wonderfully picture the Lord Jesus? Now, the Jews ended up with a man, with a friend, in a high position. Well, we have a friend who is in the highest position. Now, Jesus, he's lifted up to have the highest name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow. What does Jesus do in his high and exalted position but speak peace to you and me? That's why I read John 20 at the start of the service. When Jesus appeared to the disciples, what does he say after the resurrection? Peace be with you. Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, he says, Jesus Christ, he himself is our peace. And the Jews knew peace because of someone who was lifted up in an exalted place, who could speak on their behalf, who could care for them and watch over them. It's Mordecai. We've got someone even greater, haven't we? And the Lord Jesus who watches over us, who declares peace to us, who brings peace to us. The story of Esther reminds us that God is sovereign. He watches over and that he orchestrates all things. Well, when we remember that our God, our Lord Jesus is lifted up and speaks peace to us, actually, how much easier is it for us to submit to his sovereignty? How much easier is it to submit ourselves beneath his plans? Often, maybe doing things at times that we find challenging, going through experiences that are hard, but knowing that he is our peace. He's the one who's speaking up and working for the good of his people now. Oh, there are going to be upsets, aren't there, along the way. There's going to be other problems. The Jews were going to find other issues. We find many problems. But yet, we know that we have one who is speaking for our behalf, advocating before the Father for us, caring for us from heaven. why we can go through things that we endure here with a measure of submission. And actually, that's what we see, isn't it, consistently through the book of Esther. This question, will you submit to God's plan? Would Esther submit to God's plans that she would intercede for his people? Would Mordecai and the Jews submit themselves into the care of God? It's the same question to us, isn't it, over and over again. Do we submit and humbly accept the our place before a holy God who cares, orders, and also provides for us in every way? Now, Esther and Mordecai, what do? Well, they live by faith in the God whose love they were confident of, though we don't even find that being said on the pages of Scripture, but it's obvious. Isn't that the way we want to live too? By faith in the Son of God who loved us, confident of his goodness and overarching providence and care. We're going to stand and sing a final hymn for this evening.